You are listening to the life of Jesus Christ in a year, from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the 4-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations, available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings. We graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and Savior. We ask this in the name of the Most Holy Lamb of God and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day 5, and in this episode, we will continue reading from Volume 1. We will read chapters 4 and 5 of the section Sin and Its Consequence. 4. The Family of Adam. It was to the region of Mount Olivet that I saw Adam and Eve come. The country was very different from what it is at present, but I was assured that it was the same. I saw Adam and Eve living and doing penance on that part of Mount Olivet upon which Jesus sweat blood. They cultivated the soil. I saw them surrounded by sons. They were in great distress, and they implored God to bestow upon them a daughter, for they had received the promise that the woman's seed should crush the serpent's head. Eve bore children at stated intervals. After each birth, the number of years was always devoted to penance. It was after 7 years of penance that Seth, the child of promise, was born of Eve, in the grotto of the crib, where also an angel announced to Eve that Seth was the seed given her by God in the place of Abel. For a long time, Seth was concealed in that grotto, likewise in the cave in which Abraham was afterwards suckled, for his brothers, like those of Joseph, sought his life. Once I saw about 12 people, Adam, Eve, Cain, Abel, 2 sisters, and some young children. All were clothed in skins thrown over their shoulders like a scapular and girded at the waist. The female dress was large and full around the breast where it served as a pocket. It fell down around the limbs and was fastened at the sides, and once under the arm, the men wore shorter dresses, which had a pocket fastened to them. The skins from which their dresses were made were, from the neck to the elbow, exceedingly fine and white. They all looked very noble and beautiful in their clothing. They had huts in those days, partly sunk in the earth and covered with plants. Their household was quite well arranged. I saw orchards of low but tolerably vigorous fruit trees. There was grain also, such as wheat, which God had given to Adam for seed. I do not remember having either seen grapevines or wheat in paradise. None of the productions of paradise had to be prepared for eating. Such preparation is a consequence of sin, and therefore a symbol of labor and suffering. God gave to Adam whatever was necessary for him to sow. I remember having seen men who looked like angels, taking something to Noah when he went into the ark. It appeared to me to be a vine branch stuck in an apple. A certain kind of grain grew wild at that time, and among it Adam had to sow the good wheat. That improved it for a while, but it again degenerated and became worse and worse. The wild grain was excellent in those early times. It was most luxuriant further to the east in India or China, where as yet there were but few inhabitants. It does not thrive where wine is largely made and fish abound. The milk of animals was drunk in those days, and they likewise ate cheese dried in the sun. Among the animals, I noticed sheep in particular. All that Adam had named followed him from paradise, but afterward they fled from him. He had to entice them back with food, that is, the domestic animals, and familiarize them to himself. I saw birds hopping about like animals running around, and all sorts of bounding creatures, such as antelopes, deer, etc. The household order was quite patriarchal. I saw Adam's children in their separate huts, reclining around a stone at meals. I saw them also praying and giving thanks. God had taught Adam to offer sacrifice. He was the priest in his family. Cain and Abel also were priests in his family. I saw that even the preparations for their sacrifice took place in a separate hut. On the head, they wore caps made of leaves and their stalks woven together. They were shaped like a ship and had a rim in front by which they could be raised from the head. Those first human beings had beautiful skin of a yellowish tinge, which shone like silk, and their hair was reddish yellow like gold. Adam wore his hair long. His beard was short at first, but later he let it grow. Eve at first wore her long hair hanging around her, but later on she wound it around her head in a coil like a cap. Fire I always saw like a hidden flame, and it appeared to be in the earth. It was given to man from heaven, and God himself taught him the use of it. They burned for fuel a yellow substance that looked like earth. I saw no cooking going on. In the beginning, the food was merely dried in the sun, and the wheat, after being crushed, was exposed under twisted covers to the heat of the sun to dry. God gave them wheat, barley, and rye, and taught them how to cultivate them. He guided man in all things. I saw no large rivers in the beginning, as, for instance, the Jordan, but fountains sprang forth, whose waters were conducted into reservoirs. Flesh meat was not eaten before Abel's death. I once had a vision of Mount Calvary. I saw on it a prophet, the companion of Elias. The mount was at that time full of caves and sepulchres. The prophet entered one of the caves, and from a stone coffin filled with bones, he took up the skull of Adam. Instantly, an angel appeared before him, saying, "That is Adam's skull," and he forbade its removal. Scattered over the skull was some thin yellow hair. From the prophet's account of what had occurred, the spot was named the Place of Skulls, Calvary. Christ's cross stood in a straight line above that skull at the time of his crucifixion. I was interiorly instructed that the spot upon which the skull rests is the middle point of the earth. I was told the distance east, south, and west in numbers, but I have forgotten them. 5. Cain, the children of God, the giants. I saw that Cain conceived on Mount Olivet the design to murder Abel. After the deed, he wandered about the same spot, frightened and distracted, planting trees and tearing them up again. Then I saw a majestic figure in the form of a man refulgent with light appear to him. "Cain," he said, "where is thy brother Abel?" Cain did not at first see the figure, but when he did, he turned and answered, "I know not. He has not been given in charge to me." But when God replied that Abel's blood cried to him from the earth, Cain grew more troubled, and I saw that he disputed long with God. God told him that he should be cursed upon the earth, that it should bring forth no fruit for him, and that he should forthwith flee from the land in which he then dwelt. Cain responded that everywhere his fellow men would seek to kill him. There were already many people upon the earth. Cain was very old and had children. Abel also left children. And there were other brothers and sisters, the children of Adam. But God replied that it would not be so, that whoever should kill Cain should himself be punished sevenfold. And he placed a sign upon him that no one should slay him. Cain's posterity gradually became colored. Cham's children also were browner than those of Sem. The nobler races were always of a lighter color. They, who were distinguished by a particular mark, engendered children of the same stamp. And as corruption increased, the mark also increased until at last it covered the whole body, and people became darker and darker. But yet in the beginning there were no people perfectly black. They became so only by degrees. God pointed out to Cain a region to which he should flee. And because Cain said, "Then wilt thou let me starve?" the earth was for him accursed. God answered, "No, that he should eat the flesh of animals." He told him likewise that a nation would arise from him, and that good also would come from him. Before this, men ate no flesh. Cain went forth and built a city, which he named after his son Henoch. Abel was slain in the valley of Josaphat, opposite Mount Calvary. Numerous murders and evil deeds took place there at a subsequent period. Cain slew Abel with a kind of club that he used to break soft stones and earth when planting in the fields. The club must have been of hard stone, for it was shaped like a pickaxe, the handle of wood. We must not picture to ourselves the earth before the deluge as it is now. Palestine was by no means so broken up by valleys and ravines. Plains were far more extensive, and single mountains less lofty. The Mount of Olives was at that time only a gentle rising. The Crib Cave of Bethlehem was as later a wild cavern, but the surroundings were different. The people of those early times were larger, though not out of proportion. We would regard them with astonishment, but not with fright, for they were far more beautiful in form than people of a latter period. Among the old marble statues that I see in many places lying in subterranean caves may be found similar figures. Cain led his children and grandchildren to the region, pointed out to him, and there they separated. Of Cain himself, I have never seen anything more that was sinful. His punishment appeared to consist in hard but fruitless labor. Nothing in which he was personally engaged succeeded. I saw that he was mocked and reviled by his children and grandchildren, treated badly in every way, and yet they followed him as their leader, though as one accursed. I saw that Cain was severely punished, but not damned. One of Cain's descendants was Tubal-Cain, the originator of numerous arts and the father of the giants. I have frequently seen that when the angels fell, a certain number had a moment of repentance and did not in consequence fall as low as the others. Later on, these fallen spirits took up their abode on a high, desolate, and wholly inaccessible mountain, where sight at the time of the deluge became a sea, the Black Sea, I think. They were permitted to exercise their evil influence upon men in proportion as the latter strayed further from God. After the deluge, they disappeared from the region and were confined to the air. They will not be cast into hell before the last day. I saw Cain's descendants becoming more and more godless and sensual. They settled further and further up that mountain ridge. Where were the fallen spirits? Those spirits took possession of many of the women, ruled them completely, and taught them all sorts of seductive arts. Their children were very large. They possessed a quickness, an aptitude for everything, and they gave themselves up entirely to the wicked spirits as their instruments. And so arose on this mountain and spread far around a wicked race, which by violence and seduction sought to entangle Seth's posterity, likewise in their own corrupt ways. Then God declared to Noah his intention to send the deluge. During the building of the ark, Noah had to suffer terribly from those people. I have seen many things connected with the race of giants. They could with ease carry enormous stones high up the mountain. They could accomplish the most stupendous feats. They could walk straight up trees and walls, just as I have seen others possessed by the devil doing. They could effect the most wonderful things. They could do whatever they wished. But all was pure jugglery and delusion due to the agency of the demon. It is for that reason that I have such horror of every species of jugglery and fortune-telling. These people could form all kinds of images out of stone and metal, but of the knowledge of God they had no longer a trace. They sought their gods and the creatures around them. I have seen them scratch up a stone, form it into an extravagant image, and then adore it. They worshipped also a frightful animal and all kinds of ignoble things. They knew all things. They could see all things. They were skilled in the preparing of poisons. They practiced sorcery and every species of wickedness. The women invented music. I saw them going around among the better tribes, trying to seduce them to their own abominations. They had no dwelling houses, no cities, but they raised massive round towers of shining stone. Under those towers were little structures leading into great caverns, wherein they carried on their horrible wickedness. From the roofs of these structures, the surrounding country could be seen, and by mounting up into the towers and looking through tubes, one could see far into the distance. But it was not like looking through tubes made to bring distant objects into view. The power of the tubes to which I here allude was effected by satanic agency. They that looked through them could see where the other tribes were settled. Then they marched against them, overcame them, and lawlessly carried all before them. That same spirit of lawlessness they exercised everywhere. I saw them sacrificing children by burying them alive in the earth. God overthrew that mountain at the time of the deluge. Henoch, Noah's ancestor, opposed that wicked race by his teachings. He wrote much. Henoch was a very good man and one very grateful to God. In many parts of the open fields, he raised altars of stone, and there the fruits of the earth flourished. He gave thanks to God and offered sacrifice to him. Chiefly in his family was religion preserved and handed down to Noah. Henoch was taken up to paradise. There he waits at the entrance gate, whence with another, Elias, he will come again before the last day. Cham's descendants likewise had similar relations with the evil spirits after the deluge, and from such connections sprang so many demoniacs and necromancers, so many mighty ones of the world, so many great, wild, daring men. Semiramis herself was the offspring of demoniacs. Consequently, she was apt at everything, save the working out of her salvation. Later on, there arose another people, esteemed as gods by the heathens. The women that first allowed themselves to be ruled by evil spirits were fully conscious of the fact, though others were ignorant of it. These women had it, the principle of possession, in them like flesh and blood, like original sin. This concludes our reading today, and now we move into our reflection on the sections that we just heard, chapters 4 and 5 of Sin and Its Consequence. Today in our reading, we hear firstly about Adam and his family. So Adam's family, how Eve bore children, how they had multiple children. And as we know in the story of Adam and Eve, that it will lead to our chapter 5, Cain, the children of God and the giants, but how Cain kills Abel. And so this is the chaos, the worsening of sin in the world, that now murder enters in. Now, one of the things very mindful of, as we heard in our reading today, is just to think of the Holy Land, and according to Anne Catherine Emmerich, well, the Holy Land was this place of the original creation. Because we heard about, I saw Adam and Eve living and doing penance on the part of Mount Olivet, upon which Jesus sweat blood. They cultivated the soil. I saw them surrounded by suns. And so Adam and Eve were there on Mount Olivet. And then later we hear about Adam and his death, or the place of the skull, and how the cross was right above the spot where Adam's skull was. And so we see here kind of, you know, that original paradise, and how that original paradise is the conception of the Holy Land. For a long time, Seth was concealed in that grotto. And so that is the grotto of the crib. So again, the children of Adam and Eve, and how they are remaining in places significant later in salvation history. Again, just be mindful here too. I mentioned a few days ago how Anne Catherine Emmerich perceives and describes things from her own religious milieu. So today she says, once I saw about 12 people, Adam, Eve, Cain, Abel, two sisters, and some young children. All were clothed in skins thrown over their shoulders like a scapular and girded at the waist. So her experience in the religious life, having known of a scapular, and so she's perceiving what she sees in creation. And she's describing it. Well, it's like a scapular, she says. The household order was quite patriarchal. I saw Adam's children in their separate huts reclining around a stone at meals. I saw them also praying and giving thanks. And God taught Adam to offer sacrifice. He was the priest in his family. Cain and Abel also were priests. So here we have kind of this mentality that we have today, that fathers in their household are the leaders of family prayer, that it's really being modeled here as Anne Catherine Emmerich relates it. But to, again, just simply relish in this reality that early in creation, people prayed to God. The children of Adam in their separate huts reclining, they prayed and gave thanks. That Adam and Cain and Abel, that they gave thanks, that they led their families in prayer as the priests, as the one offering sacrifice. It's significant that kind of this theology of family that we have today, theology of the home, originating in this original family of the Old Testament. And then I think it's quite interesting that Anne Catherine Emmerich says, I was told the distances, east, south, and west, and numbers, but I have forgotten them. I think this really just points out again the fact that in the relation of these accounts of Anne Catherine Emmerich, that there can be human error. I forgot them. She received it. She knew these distances. But what I know too is that the distances here, really not necessary. Kind of a fact that we don't really need. And maybe that's why she's forgotten them, that God gives her what she needs to remember and what should be communicated to all of us. So then we have Abel, who offered the great sacrifice, and how Cain was jealous of it. And so Cain kills Abel, and his blood cries out to God. Cain grew more and troubled, and he disputed long with God. God told him that he should be cursed upon the earth, that it should bring forth no fruit for him. And so this is punishment. You know, Adam and Eve, they have their sin. They disobeyed what God said. But here you have one of the children, the descendants of Adam and Eve, And now they've taken another's life. They've killed someone. We are all devastated when we hear of murders in our world today. Hear the murder of a child or someone in your community. It devastates us. God was devastated that one of his children killed another person in creation. But he was disputing long with God. God was confronting him, and maybe just an exchange we can think of, but in our own lives, well, do we dispute with God? What is it that we dispute with God about? Maybe something for us to reflect upon spiritually. And there's punishment for this murder, for this sin. His punishment appeared to consist in hard but fruitless labor. Imagine spending your whole life and not accomplishing anything. You know, imagine this podcast. Here we are reading the life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations by Anne Catherine Emmerich. Imagine all the hard work that goes in it. Nobody listens to it. Not a single download. Now, I know that that's probably not the case. The great people at TAN, they've promoted it well. People are listening. And especially when it comes to volume 4 and its alignment with Lent next year, another push to promote it and put it in front of people and really whet their appetite to want to finish and to read the other volumes. This work that I am undertaking right now, that TAN is undertaking in this podcast, it's going to be fruitful. People are going to hear these things and think about spiritual thoughts. They're going to raise their minds to God. Their hearts are going to be changed. They're going to experience a conversion in their life that something is going to touch them so deeply. Well, that's fruitful labor. Now, it seems if Cain was doing this project, well, it would be fruitless. No listeners. Nobody would be touched. I don't know why God uses me, why God inspired me to pitch this, but I know that God's going to do amazing things, that he is providing fruitfulness in this labor. Nothing that Cain engaged in succeeded. He was mocked and reviled. Well, please, God, let that not be the case for me. It's really my own reaction to what happened to Cain. The punishment of Cain, he has his sin. I have my sins. The Lord will deal with me. The Lord will deal with you accordingly. And we just ask him to help us in all that we do and all that we undertake, that it might bear fruit for the sake of the kingdom. This brings us to an end of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelation with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you and Mary pray for you.